So thank you all for being here, and we're going to try to make this a very interactive panel. So each of us is going to talk for a little bit about a perspective on the question of free will, which I think is a question of interest to everybody. And then we'll perhaps ask each other a couple of questions, depending on what we say. We haven't planned a whole lot in advance about arranging with ourselves our positions. So then we will take questions from you all about how all of this looks from your perspective. So free will is an interesting question, and it's something that people have wondered about, and philosophers and novelists and poets and scientists have written about for thousands of years. And it is buried deep in the heart of our ethical systems and our political systems and economic systems and legal systems. So in a sense, the question, does free will exist, is an interesting philosophical question on the one hand, and it's an extraordinarily practical question on the other hand, for the legal system, for example, that at least in the United States has this notion that intent counts more than facts, and that if there's no connection between intention and action, then that whole legal notion just collapses. So this is a topic that I think is one of extreme practical importance. So if I can have the first of my slides, great. It's already up there. So the job of philosophers is, as you all know, is to draw distinctions. So this is a distinction that is very common in the philosophical literature on free will. And if you look at that literature, you'll find this stated in many, many, many different ways. But it's essentially a distinction between two concepts of what it means to have free will. And what I call the negative concept of free will is freedom from. So it's freedom from determination by some external agent. And to state this negative view very precisely, it's freedom from being completely, your actions being completely determined by some external agent. So you may say, no one believes that, that's crazy. But in history, it's maybe somewhat unfair, but it's at least a very reasonable interpretation to think that, for example, figures like Cotton Mather, who were very important in establishing what American culture in particular kind of means, believed that all of our actions were completely determined in advance by God, who wound up the clockwork universe and set it on the table, and it started ticking away. And whatever that clock did, we did. So there was a very definite puppet master who set up the universe in a fully deterministic way. And there was no concept of free will. And our actions were completely predetermined long, long, long ago by someone else. And so you may think that that view is nuts, but it's a view that has considerable historical import. And this negative concept of free will is the concept that that's not true, that there is no external agent who is controlling our actions and determining what our actions will be. So that's a concept of free will. Now, there's a very different concept of free will, which I've called the positive concept. And it's often called freedom of, as in freedom of action. But, of course, that's not very precise. So to make that more precise, The positive concept of free will stated in its strongest form is that each of you individually is completely and exclusively responsible, causally responsible for your actions. So you are not determined at all by any outside agency or force or circumstance. Your actions are your own, period. You're completely in charge. And you may also say, that's crazy, no one believes that. But many of you have been to talks or conferences, for example, where you see people like John Searle, who's a great believer in free will, and he says, free will is simple. I will my arm to go up, and it goes up. And that's all there is to it. So that's a very strong notion of the positive concept of free will. So you'll see these stated in different ways, but this is basically what it comes down to. And note that the negative concept is not just consistent with you being at least partially responsible for your actions, it in fact requires it. So if your actions are not completely determined by external agencies, then they must be at least in part determined by you. The positive concept, on the other hand, is inconsistent with any outside determination of your action. So in a sense, you can think of a sliding scale from 1 to 100, where you're 50% in charge of your life, or you're 75% in charge of your actions. I won't say in charge of your life. And one pole is 0%, and that's strong predetermination. That's kind of what's at least parodied as the Calvinist view. And 100% you in charge is what I've characterized here as the positive concept of free will, read strongly. And everything else from 1% to 99% is at least consistent with this negative concept of free will. So I think it's useful to keep this distinction in mind as we have this conversation, because these concepts are often conflated in ordinary language. And when people talk about free will, it's sometimes not completely clear whether they're talking about the negative concept or the positive concept. So it's just a good distinction to keep in mind. So if I could have the next slide, please. There's been a lot of work in quantum theory on what determination means. And a few years ago, a paper that's now become very famous was published by Conway and Kochen. And the title of the paper was The Free Will Theorem. And if you get on Google and look up Free Will Theorem, you'll get hundreds of hits. And basically what Conway-Kochen did was make a number of very simple assumptions. And they didn't assume quite all of quantum theory, but they assumed most of quantum theory. So their assumptions are very precise mathematical assumptions, and they're just a little bit weaker than quantum theory. And they prove that given those assumptions, you can arrive at the following conclusion. That if in a situation where an experimenter is manipulating the world and making an observation, if you attribute to the experimenter free choice, and Henry talked about this, for example, in his talk the other day, that the experimental is canonically viewed in quantum theory as having free choice. If you view the experimenter as having free choice, then you have to view the system being observed as having at least the same amount of free choice. And what free means here is not predictable, and Conway and Kochen emphasize this means not even predictable as a probability distribution. So this is a strong sense of not predictable. From the information that's available to either the experimenter or the system being experimented upon. So if the experimenter's actions are free with respect to the information available to the experimenter, so in relativity terms, all the events in that experimenter's past, then the responses of the system are also not determined by any information available to the system. In other words, all the events in the system's past. And that's a strong result. That got people excited. And Conway and Kochen are absolutely perfectly upfront and clear about what that means. And the quotation on the bottom is from their paper. They say, fundamental particles are continually making their own decisions. End quote. If you think that's an outrageous thing for a physicist to say, that kind of statement appears elsewhere also in the physics literature. Christopher Fuchs, for example, who founded, in a sense, quantum Bayesianism, makes a very similar statement. John Wheeler's discussions of what he calls the participatory universe makes very similar statements. So there are a lot of physicists who actually think that electrons are constantly making their own decisions. And this free will theorem gives a certain amount of formal justification of that. So can I have the next slide, please? This is my last one. So let's try to make things a little bit stronger. Let's assume all of quantum theory, and let's assume quantum theory in its deterministic version. So you often hear that quantum theory is a probabilistic theory, and quantum theory is a probabilistic theory about outcomes of measurements. But it's a deterministic theory about the dynamics. So it's deterministic about what's actually going on, and probabilistic about what we'll see when we look at what's actually going on. So these two sides of quantum theory. So if you assume that the universe has a well-defined quantum state, and you assume this deterministic dynamics as represented by the Schrodinger equation, then you can ask, what are the consequences for whether some system is determined by any outside agency? And if the universe is in a quantum state, then its evolution is a function of that entire quantum state. The Schrodinger equation is acting on that entire quantum state as a unit and sort of evolving it forward in time. And if you change anything about it, then you have a different quantum state. So if you carve out the tiniest little piece of the universe, even that tiny little pieces component of this evolution of the entire quantum state is not determined by all the rest of the universe. So even deterministic quantum mechanics, in its most deterministic form, not only justifies but absolutely requires this negative concept of free will, that not even the entire rest of the universe determines what an electron is doing. So every elementary particle has a certain, what Fuchs calls interiority, a certain, borrowing this term from William James, a certain lack of forceful input from the entire rest of the universe. And if you saw my talk a couple of days ago, this assumption that the universe has a well-defined quantum state is actually equivalent to the assumption that none of the boundaries we see around us are objectively real, that all of those boundaries are made up, which is, in fact, a position that's very similar to the position that Don Hoffman talked to you about this morning. So I'll leave you just with this, the notion that, in quantum theory at least, even if you try to be absolutely as deterministic as you could possibly be, you're still forced into a position where the most elementary entities you can imagine have at least the negative form of free will. So thank you, and I'll turn this over to Don.
Great.
It's blank so far.
On your way here.
Use your free will.
That's right, yeah.
Nope.
Actually,
using Ronald's free will.
Okay. It was showing free won't. Well, I'm going to bring a neuroscience perspective here. So we'll have two quantum talks and one neuroscience talk, and then we can see how they meet together. I'm going to suggest, while the slides are coming up, I'll telegraph what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to suggest that there are experiments that make us ask the question, is free will something that you can cut in half with a knife? That might sound pretty odd, but I'm going to show you experiments that are at least going to raise that question. Can you cut free will in half with a scalpel? There we go, dissecting free will. That's if you hit Apple Shift P, I believe, to start the thing. Or maybe it's. Does someone know how to start? I can start it if you need.
See, if you ever wonder why your computer never cooperates, it's because of free will.
Or free won't, yeah.
Sometimes if you show them a hammer.
Do we want to change the order? I could talk because I don't need to.
Oh, yeah, maybe we should switch and let you go ahead. Yeah, okay. While they're doing that. How about that? Yeah.
Okay.
So now I'm on stage. So I want to tie my remarks not only to what's just been said, but also to what we've been hearing throughout the conference, and particularly this morning's sessions. We've been informed that quantum mechanics is somehow intimately connected with these mysteries that we're talking about. On the other hand, the mysteries as they have been described have been formulated often in terms of this idea of statements can be either true or false, or half and half. And of course, quantum theory doesn't work that way. In quantum theory, you're restricting yourselves to statements that are either true or false. Quantum theorists can't go on and make a calculation, which everybody agrees with is a solid confirmation or prediction of quantum theory, some of which are exceedingly precise. The example today is one of the predictions of quantum theory is precise to the width of a human hair compared to the distance between the Earth and the Moon. So there's something very, and you can't make predictions about like this if somebody says, well, maybe this assumption that you're making is false. I mean, you have a certain range of statements that you're talking about, and within that category of statements, everything is either true or false, and all physicists agree that this calculation should be done in this way, and there's not any ambiguities. So this goes against, it doesn't exactly go against, but all of these things have been said where you equate true and false and say they're both true is not part of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is just the opposite. Everything is that you deal with is either true or false. And so how does quantum theory then put together all of these things that seem in some sense to be both true and false? Well, the point is, if you think about those things in terms of classical mechanics, then of course they're in conflict. They're in conflict, there's a contradiction, and you don't know what to do as a scientist. Now, how does quantum theory work in the sense of being able to separate things into ways that you're only dealing with true or false statements? And the main premise of quantum theory was this fundamental idea that whereas in classical mechanics, you thought the fundamental description was in terms of physically described material stuff. In quantum theory, the primary move was already the essential move, and it says, what is science? Science comes from, as you heard this morning if you were there, comes from the word skira, to know. So it's about what we know. And the essence of the essential assumption of quantum theory is that the theory is a description of what we know, the knowledge that we gain from doing experiments and having experienced our life experiences. And so the way that the theory works is that the point is there are three separate realities that enter into quantum mechanics. The first one is the observer. The observers are people like ourselves, as prime examples, who have experiences. And the second part is nature. The function of the observer is to pose certain questions about the nature of what seems to be the physically described world. And then nature is supposed to answer these questions according to certain statistical rules. So we have already two separate elements of this reality, the observers and nature, who's answering the questions that we ask. And then the third element of reality is called the quantum state. And ultimately, it's the quantum state of the universe. And this is another reality, and it's described in the same terms, physically described terms that you describe the classically described universe. In other words, it's described by assigning mathematical properties to space-time points. So this description is in that sense the same as or very similar to the description of classical mechanics. But the thing that is described does not have the ontological properties of the material world of classical mechanics. Its ontological character is the character of potentiality, possibilities. It's a realm of possibilities, a realm of potentialities. Potentialities for what? Well, I've already said that the observer poses a question. And the question it poses is of the form, will my experience be such and such? And then he describes in some detail, or imagines in some detail, what the experience that he would be a yes answer to his question. And so the observer enters in a very dynamical way into the dynamics. He has to pose these questions, and nature answers, but the thing that is holding the question and the answer is the quantum state of the universe. And this state is not a material state, it's a state of potentialities, and these potentialities are possible answers to the question that he is posing. So the essential point here is this state of the universe, which we might tend to think of in material terms, is not at all like a material universe. It's a realm of possible answers to the questions that the experimenter has posed. The way the system works is that given this state of the universe, and then given the question that's being asked, there are some calculations that you go through, and that produces a statistical the yes and no answers to the questions are giving statistical weights. In other words, if you do a large number of experiments, it seems that 50% or maybe 30% of the time you get yes, and 70% you get no. And so the main point here is that the reality, this experiential reality, has three experiential parts. It has the experience of asking the questions, the observers, and it's called the free choice part of the experiment. That's going to tie it into free choice. There's a free choice on the part of the experimenter, and then there's this, the free choice is, then in order to, so the experimenter in asking the question is basically able to get an impression on the basis of his own personal experiences. His own personal experiences in life is a series of asking questions and getting responses, asking questions and getting responses, and that builds up a certain internal idea of who I am. If I ask this question, I get this response, and also evaluating those. You get a value. This is a bad response. This is a good response. So the observer, on the basis of his experience, asking these questions and getting response, builds up an idea of an I. An I who has the capacity to act, and an I who has evaluated these possibilities. So there is an impression, the psychological impression of who I am. I'm a person that can ask these questions, get these responses with these values. So you're able to act in a way that allows you to, and you have this feeling of, if I ask this question, I'll get this sort of response, which has this sort of value. So you are able to impose your values onto the evolution of the physical universe in a way that is both based on your values and what's called your free choice. That word enters very prominently, the free choice on the part of the experimenter. Now, what does free choice mean in that context? The primary requirement of being a free choice in quantum theory is that this choice is not determined by the physically described aspect of the universe. The physically described aspect is this state of the universe that's described in physical terms, describing mathematical properties of space-time points. It's not determined by that part of the universe. It's determined by something else, and the something else is supposed to be the experience or his himself, his image of himself with his values, which is then able to impose or be impressed upon. Well, nature's first got to respond. I at least can ask the question, and nature this is then going to respond yes or no. Now, there's another aspect of this that is very important. It's although the observer is only allowed to ask questions, pose a question, do a probing action, because of something called the quantum Zeno effect, and more importantly, something that's sometimes called the anti-quantum Zeno effect, the observer, by the capacity to control his questions and the timing of these questions, is actually able to, you can understand how it is by given this capacity of the observer to ask the questions and pose the questions, it allows you to, through the action, and the nature is actually doing the work. You're just asking nature, nature is responding, but because of the rules of quantum theory, in these situations where you ask the questions very rapidly, nature's response is almost surely going to be a yes to certain questions. So that yes, series of yes answers actually is allowed to move the state of your brain in such a way that you can understand the fact that I can will my arm to rise and my arm rises. So, so from this quantum mechanical point of view, which, as I stress, doesn't allow any statements that are both true and false. It's all well-organized in terms of rationally coherent understanding of things in terms of statements that are either true or false, and there's none of this fuzziness. That doesn't mean that all these things that we've been hearing about are not true in some sense, but they're all sorted out in a way in terms of statements that are either true or false, and that's what quantum theory provides you, a way for understanding, and in a way understanding the fact that your free choices, and by the way, I should say that these free choices seem to be able to access the, to look down on the system of possibilities that is existing in the state of the universe, and it chooses basically from among the various possibilities. And an important point is that if you're looking at the brain, the actions of the brain, there are things called ion channels. Ion channels are huge molecules that have a little hole kind of through them, and ions like calcium ions and potassium flow through these ion channels, and when they emerge, they're passing through the cell wall, and they go to the inside of the cell, and because of the very narrow size of the hole and the uncertainty principle, their velocity when they exit these holes is very undetermined. So they can be, there's a smear of possible worlds, so what that means is that by virtue of these, the dependence upon these ion channels, the brain is going to, in a quantum mechanical universe, be able to describe lots of alternative possibilities for what could happen. For example, if you're in the dark forest and something jumps out at you, there's the fight or flight. I mean, am I going to do this or am I going to do that? And according to this picture, both of these possibilities will emerge into this quantum state of potentialities, and the observer looking essentially with a certain access to this realm of possibilities is able to, on the basis of who he is, what his values are, and his prior experience, actually select one or the other of these and ask the question, is it true? And by virtue of the quantum Zeno effect, if you ask the questions fast enough, you can basically force the statement to be true, in which case you're allowed to understand through neuroscience and through the action of a quantum mechanically described neuroscience the capacity of you to control your actions. By the way, in the free choice theorem that you're talking about, just to kind of answer this question in advance, this theorem has two things that are somewhat objectionable. One, there is assumption in it that amounts to assumption of locality, the failure of non-locality. And of course, I think that that is contradictory to quantum theory. Quantum theory has non-locality built into it in an essential way. And secondly, the way that the theorem is formulated, it says that the particles are deciding what they're going to do. If the observer's choice over here is free, then the particle is free to choose, inherits the freedom, and it has a freedom to choose. But of course, in this quantum mechanical view that I've been describing, it's not that the particle itself has any knowledge, because what happens is, what is really predicted is the results of the experiments that are performed on the particles. And so for various possible choices, you can perform, you have various possibilities which experiment you're going to perform, but it's nature that makes the choice. It's not the particle that somehow has consciousness and is able to make the choice. Within this framework, at least, it is nature that makes the choice, and so it gives to nature a certain freedom of choice, not that it gives an individual electron somehow a mentality that can choose. So I think that's how it gets around the free will problem. Nature certainly does have a free choice, and by the way, I can conclude by saying that, in fact, this question of the character of nature was basically posed to me by a question. I wrote an article called The Copenhagen Interpretation of Quantum Theory back in 1972, and Heisenberg, I asked Heisenberg to comment upon it, and he said, this raises the question of what happened, what is the world like before there were any human observers or any observers? And his answer said that he pointed to this Platonic idea of an idea-like something, an idea-like aspect of nature that is existing within nature itself. And I think what that ultimately boils down to is the fact that I think this requires this nature that we're talking about here probably to itself have some sort of idea-like character. In other words, this idea is not just a mechanical thing, but it itself has this idea-like quality. So all three of these three aspects of reality, the observer and his choices, the quantum mechanical reality, and the choice on the part of the observer, all three have an idea-like, a basically idea-like character. And so consciousness, right at the very beginning of quantum mechanics, the quantum mechanics that I'm talking about here can be extended to relativistic quantum field theory, but already at the very beginning, when it was a non-relativistic theory, you already had the essential ingredients that we're talking about here, the three parts of reality, all of which are basically idea-like in nature.
Thank you. Don?
So we'll...
Can we have Don's slides up again? Thank you.
Okay, great. So we'll switch a little bit from quantum theory to from the microscopic to the macroscopic. The brain, as you know, is an electrochemical computer with 86 billion neurons and trillions of synapses and a 3D layout. And in epilepsy, you have a part of the brain that has random bad signatures, electrical activity. It's called an epileptic focus, and this can cause a storm of electrical activity over the entire brain that causes seizures and loss of consciousness. And it can be life-threatening if you're driving or even walking and you fall. It could be life-threatening. And often there are drugs like clonazepam that can deal with this, but sometimes they don't. And so in extreme cases, they do a surgery. And the basis of the surgery is this diagram of the brain. You have the brain has two hemispheres, a left and a right, and there's a band of cables called the corpus callosum between the, it's actually a signaling system between the left and right hemisphere. About 225 million axons. It's a little bit bigger in women than men. They're better connected. So there's a connecting cable, and it's got that many neurons. So that's sort of the idea. So the idea of the surgery was this. If there's a focus, an epileptic focus, say, on the left hemisphere, and it's causing random neural activity and a seizure, and drugs aren't working to stop it, maybe we can confine the seizure to one hemisphere. If we cut this corpus callosum with a knife, we can separate the two hemispheres. The electrical activity can't go across to the other hemisphere and cause it to go down. That was the idea. Big risk, but they tried it. So they did it, so cut the cable and confined the storm to one hemisphere. That was the hope, and it worked. It was a clinical success beyond people's expectations. In many cases, the seizures either were greatly diminished or disappeared altogether. And this raised a question, okay, what's different about these people, right? So this is great, but now they've got their brains cut in half. What's different about them? And it turns out, they act normal. For most of them, their families, their spouses, their immediate families, their friends can't tell any difference. You know, well, of course, after the surgery is healed, right? To do the surgery, you have to shave your head, cut off your top of your skull like, you know, pumpkin at Halloween and get in there. So there's a lot of scars and so, but after that's all healed, then you look normal and you act normal. Even to a psychologist, acolytist in the 1940s, who did careful studies on these patients, couldn't find anything different about them. So they began to, you know, remark like maybe the corpus callosum is there just to conduct epileptic seizures. I mean, but, you know, probably not. So then Sperry in 1960s in Caltech did some experiments. And I'm just going to show you a version of his experiments. He won the Nobel Prize for the stuff I'll just tell you about right now. So in his experiment, you have a subject, which that's the best I can do for a human subject. And that's the best I can do for a computer screen. So the subject, S, views a computer screen, and an X appears on it, and the subject just has to look at the X. It's called a fixation cross. So they look at the fixation cross, and then a phrase like keyring appears on the screen for a tenth of a second, and it disappears. And so the screen goes blank, and all the subject has to do is just say what they saw. For normals, it's easy. If you do this experiment, it's drop-dead easy. Everybody gets it 100% right. You say key ring, no problem. What's the issue here? For the split-brain patients, so the normals, is they say key ring. It's easy. For the split-brain, they just say, I saw the word ring. And you say, well, you know, wedding ring, doorbell ring, key ring, what kind of ring? Ring, that's all I know. Then you say, well, with your left hand, I'm going to give you a box of stuff, put a blindfold on you. There's a bunch of stuff in there. I want you to pick out with your left hand what you read on the screen. The left hand will go through, and it might actually pick up a ring, and it'll pick up a ring, put it down, and keep going until it finds a key, and it pulls out a key. If you have them do it with the right hand, it'll go through, they're blindfolded. It goes through, it might pick up a key first, it puts it down until it finds a ring, it pulls it out. You unblindfold them, the two hands have different things. One has a key, one has a ring. And if you ask the person, well, you said you saw the word ring, how come you picked out a key with your left hand? They either go, I have no idea, or they make up a story that's just false. Confabulate. So when they, if you have the hands do it at the same time, they work independently. And one, the left hand pulls out a key, the right hand pulls out a ring. So, and if you have them pull something out with their left hand, if you blindfold them and just put anything in their left hand, and ask them what it is, they can't tell you what it is. If you put it in the right hand, they can. But if you put it in the left hand, they can't tell you what it is. Okay? That's the first experiment. So the second experiment, and this is even weirder. So in this experiment, they just look at the fixation cross briefly, and then they're told that there's going to be a disc that appears just to the left of the fixation cross for a tenth of a second, and it can be white or black. And on each trial, all they have to do is say what the color was. So every trial, something will appear, and they just have to say white or black. And for normals, yeah, so that's that. So for normals, trivial, 100%. Your confidence, just no problem. This is like, give me something hard. Split brain, 50%. And it's clear they're guessing. They go, I don't know, white? And half the time they're right, half the time they're not right. And you give them no feedback, no smiles, no nothing. You don't tell them if they're right or wrong. You could even just have a tape recorder that you hit. You just ask them the question again. What color was the disc? Then they get it 100%. And they're confident. They know the answer. And you've given them no feedback. So those are the experimental data, and they might be a bit confusing. What's going on is as follows. The two hemispheres have different functions. The left hemisphere is the only hemisphere that talks. The right hemisphere can understand language, but it can't talk. It can cuss. If you have a stroke in your left hemisphere, you can't talk, but you still are able to cuss. The right hemisphere can still do that. And the left hemisphere controls your, I'm sorry, the right hemisphere controls your left hand and also feels what's in the left hand. And the left hemisphere controls and gets sensory information from the right hand. So what's going on then is, the neat thing is that the notion of visual fields. When you, if you look at the X, anywhere you look to the, when you look at that X, for example, or some of you can't see that, so take this disc up here in the front. If you're looking at that disc, everything to the left of the disc is your left visual field. Everything you see to the right is your right visual field. And every time you move your eyes and look somewhere else, your visual fields have moved, right? Just everything to the left of where you're now looking is your left visual field. Everything to the right is your right visual field. Okay? So what happened was, when the guy had an X on the screen and the phrase key ring flashed up on the screen, the word key was in the left visual field. The word ring is in the right visual field. And it turns out that the way the brain is organized and the optic nerve is organized is that the left visual field gets seen by your right hemisphere, and the right visual field gets seen by your left hemisphere. So it's not that your right eye sees the right field and the left eye sees the left field. Each eye sees both fields. Your left eye sees both visual fields. But it's that the right visual field maps in a strange way only to your left hemisphere. The left visual field only maps only to the right hemisphere. So what happens in this experiment is the word key goes to the right hemisphere and the word ring goes to the left. And so the reason the person says, I saw a ring, is because the left hemisphere sees the word ring. It didn't see the word key. So it only says what it knows. The right hemisphere saw the word key, so it can control the left hand to pick up a key, but it can't talk, so it can't say what went on. Okay. So what you have, by the way, in terms of consciousness studies, is two hemispheres with distinct spheres of consciousness. One is conscious of the word key, one is conscious of the word ring, and there's no one that's conscious of both. By taking a scalpel, Joe Bogan, a guy I actually knew who did these surgeries, by cutting the corpus callosum in half, he cut consciousness in half. Literally cut consciousness in half. So consciousness is something you can cut with a knife. So now the reason for the tenth of a second is that's not enough time to move your eyes. If you have enough time to move your eyes, you can move your eyes around so that the key ring stuff goes to both hemispheres. So that's why they have a brief presentation of this stuff. So now what's interesting now, so I've explained all that. So did we dissect for, so there's a couple things now that I'll say about this. It seems like the normal subjects, when you ask them to pick up what they saw, they would pick up a key ring. The two hemispheres are working together. There's one decision, one free will choice, and they pick up a key ring. As soon as you cut the corpus callosum with a knife, you get two separate decisions, two separate free will decisions. Someone decides to pick up a key. Someone decides to pick up a ring. And so they seem like two separate free will decisions based on two separate conscious experiences. And it gets even more interesting. Sometimes these patients exhibit what's called intermanual conflict, a knotty left hand. So one woman that had this went to get dressed for work, and her right hand picked out an appropriate business dress and started to put it on, and the left hand grabbed, you know, a slinky thing for a party, and would not let go. So she'd have to get her pride out of her hand. And then when she was actually dressing and trying to button up her dress, the right hand would button it up, the left hand would unbutton it. Right? Clearly separate free will. She goes to make an omelet. The right hand is making a nice omelet. The left hand throws in an entire egg, a salt shaker, and an onion. Clearly someone likes omelets and someone doesn't. And they have different free will decisions. And you can actually send messages to the right hemisphere in the middle of an experiment. Gazzaniga did an experiment where the guy doing an experiment, and all of a sudden, without any clue or you know warning, he flashes the word walk to the left visual field of the person. So it goes only to the right hemisphere. The left hemisphere doesn't see anything. And the person gets up and starts walking. And Gazzaniga feigns surprise. He goes, what's going on here? We're in the middle of an experiment. Why are you walking away? And the guy, without missing a beat, says, oh, I'm thirsty. I need a Coke. Well, who's talking? It's the left hemisphere. The left hemisphere doesn't know why he's walking, and it doesn't know that it doesn't know. It's confabulating a story to make itself look good. And most of our beliefs about ourselves are, in fact, the left hemisphere confabulations made up after the fact that have no bearing on reality. They're just there to make us look good. And so now this raises all sorts of questions about free will. By the way, I didn't explain the one thing. What about the black and white disc? How did the patient get that, not the first time, and did get it the second time? What's going on there is that the first time, who saw the color of the disc? It was in the left visual field. Only the right hemisphere saw it. So the left didn't see it, and it can't talk. So the person says, I don't know, because the left hemisphere doesn't know. Well, the right hemisphere hears the answer. And if the guy is right, it shakes the head yes, and if he's wrong, he shakes his head no. And all of a sudden, the left hemisphere goes, oh, I must have got it wrong. So you just ask the question again, and he gets it right. So now what's going on is the two hemispheres are communicating with each other in the way that different people communicate with each other. You use your body, like I'm doing right now, to talk to you, because you can't get directly what's in my head. I can't get directly what's in your head. We have to use our bodies to communicate. The two hemispheres normally can do that when they're connected, but now they have to use the external body to communicate. So this raises all sorts of questions about free will, and I'll close with this. First, many of our beliefs about free will could be complete confabulations. I think 99% of what I believe about myself, my motives, and my reasons for doing things, is just false. It's just a story I make up that's completely false. So maybe free will is in that category. But on the other hand, picking up a key or picking up a ring or putting on a negligee versus a business dress does seem like a free choice. And cutting the corpus callosum with a knife does seem to take one unified free will and split it into two. And I'll stop with that.
So, thank you. I'll just make a couple of remarks, and then I'll pass on to my fellow panelists. The first remark is in response to your implicit question, Henry, and yes, Henry's absolutely right that the Conway-Kochen theorem does make a locality assumption. It assumes that the universe is divided into three parts, an experimenter, a system being experimented on, and everything else, which physicists tend to call the environment. And so in the context of the theorem, like in many other contexts in quantum mechanics, actually, the environment is completely ignored. No one talks about the environment at all. And the freedom is ascribed to the system only. And that is, in fact, a view, a way of talking that, at least in my opinion, makes a critical error of treating this boundary around the system as an objective boundary. The Conway-Kochen theorem, in fact, makes that assumption, which I do regard as an erroneous assumption. It is also, I think, an erroneous assumption to imagine that the observer is localized and distinct from the environment. So my question for Henry is, do you believe that the observer is actually part of nature?
Is part of what?
Nature.
Yes, absolutely. I think the best way to understand things is there is this nature, which itself is mental, fundamentally mental, and you might even say conscious, at least mental in its basic structure. And each observer is somehow an aspect of that larger reality. And it appears that certain physical structures, take a brain, are such that they attract to it an aspect of the greater reality, which you might call the individual experiencer or the stream of consciousness that's associated with this particular structure. And so the whole thing is consciousness, nature, we call it, and this consciousness is nature, basically. And it has aspects that are somehow pulled down when there is a piece of nature, a piece of the physical structure that enables it to have an impact upon the physical state of the universe that allows it must allow this aspect to form an idea of an I. In other words, it has to gain some experience through its interaction with the physically described universe, and which is idea-like in character. And once you have a certain amount of communication of that sort, there is a consciousness I that's based on the realm of experience that's associated with this brain, and that's how you answer the basic question that is not really answered in the original form of quantum theory. The original form of quantum theory thought there was no problem with somehow identifying the experiencers. I mean, we were the experiencers, and there are not these subtle questions. Also, the question also immediately arose, how about dogs, how about cats, how about worms, how about amoeba? And So it wasn't immediately answered, but each of these at least has a little bit of potentiality of having a realm of experience that is could create an image of an I. And it's, of course, a matter of degree. I mean, we have a lot more experience. So yes, basically, the eyes are a part of the overall nature that is created by the fact that you have a piece of the physical universe that interacts with it in its appropriate way.
I just got a time warning, so I think we're only are going to have time for a couple of questions. So, do either of you have a question that you would, at this point,
I have one
really
question.
Like to ask?
One quick one for you, and that is, did I understand you correctly to say that you think that nature itself is conscious or composed of consciousnesses?
You did.
Okay.
Yes, it is nature. Okay. It is conscious, yeah. And it is also composed of consciousnesses in the fact that these individual parts can kind of be part of it. And
do you think that Heisenberg in his later years might have agreed or disagreed with you on that?
Well, as I told you, I wrote this article mm-hmm. after working with Heisenberg for a few months in Munich. I went back and wrote this article, mm-hmm. The Copenhagen Interpretation, and on the basis of what I and also my earlier conversations with Pauli, thought was my way of explaining what they were trying to say in words that I could understand better. And Heisenberg kind of complimented me on my, but then he asked kind of this question, what about the universe before there were any experiencers? And his answer, as I say, referred to the Platonic idea of a realm of ideas that were somehow in the universe, somehow. And the suggestion, I think, was that this nature itself had that character. I mean, had the character of conscious experiences.
Okay.
And then our own experiences are little sub-parts of it that are somehow connected to bits of matter.
So you'd say yes. You would say yes that Heisenberg thought.
I would say yes.
Wow. Okay. That's
very good. Do we have time for a couple of questions from the floor? Oh, pardon me? Okay, let's have, and you can.
Thank you. This has been amazing. I'm wondering about the interiority of fundamental particles, if they're void of external influence. Would you call that the ground of being, pure consciousness? It seems to me it would be void of influence because it's outside of any system that has an inside and outside or anything to influence or be influenced by. What Hafiz would call the ground of being where the rose ever blooms. Is that what you're talking about?
Is that directed to
you? I'm actually not sure I understood your question. Could you...
All right. It was stated that the interiority of the fundamental particles of matter are void of any external influence.
Oh, okay. I'm the one who made that statement, essentially quoting Chris Fuchs, who introduced this idea of any quantum system having interiority. And he was not stating that they were devoid of any external influence. He was rather saying that external influence didn't explain everything, that there was at least some influence left over to whatever the system was. And, you know, Chris Fuchs is once again making this assumption of boundedness, which quantum theorists tend to make. I think it would be fair to say, if I understood the second half of your question, that the ground of being could be thought of in physical terms as what I referred to as what's happening, and I think of as what Henry referred to as the physical universe.
Thank you.
Taking into account that this is a very decidedly non-classical, non-material object notion of a physical universe.
Let me partly answer that also by saying that something that I neglected to say is within quantum theory, we have this statement, free choice on the part of the experimenter. That's a fundamental statement by Bohr that reiterated often. Now, what does that free choice mean really in that context? And the main thing that it means, this freedom means it's not determined by the physically described part of the universe. There's something else that's got to come in, and free choice is about that something else, and how about it's coming from mind.
Okay, one more question.
David Bohm's idea of causality, I read somewhere, is that there's a million events which are causes, and you are, you know, you as an observer are contributing as one of those many, many events, and each of them have a different weightage. And all of those events contribute to an effect. And immediately that effect becomes one of million other causes which cause the next effect. And this is how causality in the universe goes on. So in that sense, your free will or your choice is just one of many causes. Could you comment?
Did you understand that question?
I didn't understand a word of it. Sorry. I have a bad hearing, and no. I couldn't understand it.
Can you repeat the question, please?
Maybe real short.
In David Bohm's idea of causality, cause and effect, you know, millions of causes, different weightages, giving rise to one effect.
Yes. Okay. And now, would you like to comment on Bohm's
theory? I didn't understand. What's the question?
Okay. He asked about David Bohm's idea of causality.
David Bohm.
And whether free will is consistent with a Bohmian notion of causality. I can hand that over, or I can take a crack at it either way.
Well, you take it first.
Oh, okay. I'm not an expert on Bohm's view of quantum theory, but what I have read of Bohm emphasizes very explicitly the notion that the causal influence that gives a particle its apparent classical trajectory is the entire rest of the universe. So Bohm accepts the idea that the universe itself is always in a fully entangled state. So this notion of causality in Bohmian theory, at least as I read it, is utterly non-classical and does not go from the past to the future. It's sort of the entire universe resonating with itself produces what we see in our limited way as causation. But that's my reading of Bohm's notion.
I've talked to Bohm himself at length on this question. In the first place, he insists that, as you know, there are in the Bohmian all of these possible realms. You have all of these different possible classical trajectories through space-time. And the first question is, does only one of them exist, or do they all somehow exist in some sort of superposed? And he was insistent that there's only one that's the real world. All the rest of them are non-real and and as you say, this one, however, is entangled in this very complex way with everything that's happening to every other particle. This trajectory is not described in a three-dimensional space. It's described in this huge dimensional where every particle has its own three dimensions. So it's described in this gigantic space which allows everything to become entangled. When you say that this Bohmian description is local in this 3n dimensional space where n is bigger than any number, and it is local in that space, but it is highly non-local in three-dimensional space. And although there is from that point of view, there is a deterministic universe, it is not understandable as deterministic in three-dimensional space. I'm not sure if that answers the
question. I think we're probably out of time, so I thank you very much for coming and patiently listening to us.